Heartbeat Alaska is made possible by the following. By Coca-Cola, serving Alaska quality soft drinks since 1937.
And by the South Central Foundation, serving Alaska Natives and American Indians in South Central Alaska.
And by the Alaska Seafood Marketing Institute, educating consumers and promoting sales of Alaska seafood throughout the U.S. and in international markets.
There's a heartbeat louder than thunder. Revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool?
Hello and welcome to Heartbeat Alaska. I'm Jeannie Green. Thank you so much for joining us for more Native news. Hello to our viewers in Nebraska and our new viewers in Mississippi, as well as all the good people across Canada. We're so glad that you're with us. In Alaska, we're traveling to Wrangell, Alaska, thanks to Annette Thompson from Kasan. She sent in a video of her incredibly inspiring mother, Edna Haaseth. Edna Haaseth is 81 years old. She's a really neat lady. Then we travel to Kasigluk, Alaska, where along with the students, we learn how to skin a caribou. Recently, Heartbeat Alaska flew over to Hooper Bay to cover their youth jamboree. All that plus much more. But first, here's Gary Fife with Native news across the nation.
This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife. Tribes of the Pacific Northwest are asking President Clinton to help prevent the destruction of salmon in northwestern rivers, and they've compared the situation of the fish to that of the buffalo. In a news conference this past week, tribal leaders asked the president to declare a state of emergency for the salmon to end a violation of an 1855 treaty and halt the loss of the fish. The tribes and several state agencies are suing the federal government over its failure to protect the resource, saying there's not enough water to support salmon life cycles. A White House official told a Senate panel that protecting salmon is a priority for the administration, but did not comment on a tribal request. President Clinton has reaffirmed his position on the opening of the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge in Alaska, and that position is good news for the Gwich'in Athabascans. He opposes it. He wrote of his stance in a letter to the tribe February 28th, saying the area will continue to be managed for its wildlife and wilderness. That is in direct opposition to the position of some Inupiat Eskimos who favor opening Anmar. In a correction to a story last week, the members of the Mescalero tribe of New Mexico have decided in favor of hosting a nuclear waste dump on their reservation. Tribal officials have been pursuing the idea of a monitored retrieval storage site, an MRS, for years now. A petition circulated among tribal members brought over 700 signatures asking the tribal council to reconsider the issue for its economic possibilities. In a second tribal referendum on the issue, the tribe voted for the plan. The Navajo Nation flag has been in space. During a recent flight of the space shuttle Discovery, astronaut Bernard Harris Jr. took one of the Navajo Nation flags with him. Harris says, "I'm flying this flag for them because being there, I could see their plight as the original Americans." Harris lived among the tribe during a part of his childhood while his mother taught at a local boarding school. Navajo President Albert Hale gave his consent after being assured by tribal spiritual people that no traditions were being violated. A Kansas state representative says she'll sponsor a bill to honor a Muscogee Creek man who helped Creek Union sympathizers escape to Kansas during the Civil War. Representative Rochelle Chronister is working to have the Big Sandy River Valley area designated as a historic trail in honor of Creek prophet and leader Apotla Yohola. The Creek helped the refugees during 1861 at a period when much of the Muscogee Creek Nation favored the Confederacy. The Coeur d'Alene tribe of Idaho is going ahead with its plans to conduct a new national lottery starting in August. The tribe got approval for its plan from the Federal Indian Gaming Commission to run its lottery in 32 states at first. The Coeur d'Alene's plan to use the windfall for tribal needs and programs to replace federal dollars. The Great American Lottery, as it's being billed, will allow players to use credit cards, with winning numbers being published in national papers and on television. Legislation to allow Alaska Natives to sell their shares of corporate stock is on the floor of the U.S. Senate. Alaska Senator Frank Murkowski guided the measure through his committee in order to allow Cook Inlet Region Incorporated to buy back shares of stock from its membership. Right now, such sale is prohibited by the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act, ANCSA, and the measure is being seen as a test case for other Alaska Native corporations. And finally, the murder trial of O.J. Simpson has finally included a Native American angle. A 52-year-old man of half Native and half Caucasian descent was dismissed from the trial of the controversial TV star. The man was dismissed by Judge Lance Ito, but no reason was given in court. The New York Daily News reported files found in a juror's computer indicated he may have been preparing a book on the controversial trial. This is Native News Across the Nation. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Gary Fife.
Revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool to care? So clever, never speak too soon. You, one who knows better, to be sliding in and out of the room. With your friends close, your enemies closer. Careful now, not to force her. There's a heartbeat louder than thunder. Revolution is in the air.
Heartbeat Alaska Jackets. Order one today. Send $65 to Heartbeat Alaska, 2611 Fairbanks Street, Unit D, Anchorage, Alaska, 99503. Call area code 907-272-8111.
For many of us here in Alaska, our diets are supplemented by wild game. Though it may seem cruel or even unfashionable to some, without that wild game, many of us would go hungry. Traditional food means food on the table. In Kasigluk, Alaska, the students are learning just how to prepare that food for their table. Caribou. How to skin it and how to butcher it. The students have studied muskrats, mink, waterfowl, and various fish from this area. In the process, they dissect the species, naming the various parts. They were lucky this past week. Two hunters brought in two caribou for the students to skin and cut up. Skinning and dissecting local animals are part of the Yupik Studies program at Akuluk Iliknarvik School in Kasigluk, Alaska. The program is based on what the community's expectations are for their children and what the community really wants for their children. In Kasigluk, what the community wants is knowledge of the Yupik ways and culture that will be useful after the student graduates. Learning to dissect the species and name the various parts, both in Yupik and English, are important to the people's survival. One of the Yupik Studies teachers, Levi Hoover, invited three village elders, Irvin Brink Sr., Anesia Hoover, and Sophie Nichols, to come to the school and demonstrate to the students how to skin and cut up the caribou. The students watched for a while and then participated in the process. For the next several weeks, the information will be integrated into the regular biology and English classes. The students will be writing about the experience, both in Yupik and English, drawing illustrations and making reports. Some of the meat was given to the elders who have played a very important part in the success of the Yupik Studies program. And some of the meat will be kept for the Yupik Dance and Elders Festival, and the rest will be preserved and cooked in the traditional ways by the students. Caribou meat is eaten throughout the year, and usually eaten fresh or preserved by freezing. Some caribou meat is dried throughout the year as weather permits, especially in the spring. And as with moose, most parts are eaten, including the meat, the liver, the stomach, and the heart. The Yupik community of Kasigluk, Alaska is taking classroom studies a step further. Skinning a moose and dissecting fish may seem a strange part of curriculum in other parts of the world. But here in Kasigluk, Alaska, it's all part of survival, part of a tradition that's gone on for thousands of years. And for these students and the exorbitant prices of groceries in rural Alaska, it truly is a means to survival. For Heartbeat Alaska and Real TV, I'm Jeannie Green. From Kasigluk, Alaska, for Heartbeat Alaska and Real TV, I'm Jeannie Green.
Also learned how to make caribou stew, one of my favorites, and I'm sure they did. We'll be back in just a moment as we travel to Hooper Bay.
Cervical cancer is easy to treat and most of the time completely curable if caught in the early stages.
Did you know that cancer is the leading cause of death of Alaska Native women? Did you know that Alaska Native women are more likely to get cervical cancer than non-Native women? Why is that? It's because we're not always finding the problem early enough to stop it before it becomes cancer. Why? Because not enough of us are getting regular pap tests. The pap test is the first step in diagnosing cervical cancer. Here's another fact. Although pap smears are free, many Alaska Native women, too many of us, are not getting them yearly. We all need to make a yearly pap test a part of all other things we do as women to keep ourselves healthy.
Everyone should do it every year in case there's a new problem that could lead to cervical cancer.
For more information about South Central Foundation, please write South Central Foundation, 670 West Fireweed Lane, Anchorage, Alaska, 99503, or call our administrative office at area code 907-265-4900.
Before we move on, I'd like to thank Charlie Isaac and Bill Ferguson from Kasigluk, Alaska, for contributing to that story. Let's travel on over to Hooper Bay for their first annual Youth Jamboree.
Hooper Bay is on the southwest western coastline of the Bering Sea in the Yukon Kuskokwim area. It is 100 miles west. This was just a guess a while back, northwest from Bethel. The population of Hooper Bay today in 1995 is about 1,200. And it is the oldest village in the Bethel area. It is known that all Yupik coastal people are called Tinakamut. Through generation after generation, people have been settled here. It has been inhabited for about 1,000 years.
Hooper Bay and CMTRS, which is a chemical misuse treatment recovery service, you sponsor this first annual youth leadership jamboree is to get all the presenters from outside of Hooper Bay and within Hooper Bay to let these school kids in high school to realize that leadership is very important and education is very important.
I got about 25 minutes to tell my life history and what I'm involved in and what the sobriety movement is all about. My name is Greg Nothstine, that's my Christian name. My Inupiaq name is Tangunup. I'm the son of Sophie Larena Tangunup, who's from the village of Wales, that's just east of Nome. I'm half Inupiaq and I'm half Pennsylvanian Dutch. I never learned how to speak my Inupiaq language, unfortunately, because I was constantly going back and forth to Anchorage, to Nome. And just before I began to speak Inupiaq, I was brought to Anchorage and I learned nothing but English.
Greg Nothstine may not know his native tongue, but he speaks clearly in the language of sobriety. He was one of the many presenters at the Hooper Bay Leadership Jamboree.
As you would, release me of the bondage of self that I would better do your will. Take away my difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness to those that would help of your power, your love, and your way of life. May I do your will always, that I may continue to be a living example of the road you have made for our people and our children to follow. The obstacles appear so great, however, the peaceful way of life can be accomplished only by those of us with strong courage and the purification of all living things. Let it begin with me.
Let it begin with me. The Leadership Jamboree emphasized this message to the youth. They are all potential leaders, not only in sobriety, but in their communities and state as well.
Each of them is a leader in their own way, in their own time. To give them some of the tools that they may need to be good leaders.
He's been the mayor for quite a few years, and he's been working for the people and trying to get them to doing things that he'd like seeing done as a group, as a community, and not individually and selfishly, but as a community as a whole. And during this festival, Louis Bunyan Sledag Memorial Festival, people get together singing, dancing, and generally having fun, generally getting together. And that's what he's been working to strive for, getting the community together to work as one.
Working as one, yet each learning to become a leader. It's probably one of the greatest strengths of the Yupik people. As Greg Nothstine says, it's like the blanket toss. It takes many people to make it possible, all pulling together, each in sync with the other, yet contributing their own individual strength.
And it sounds like a heartbeat. It can be, what would happen to that heartbeat if people started to drink? What would happen to this hope, this cooperation, this support? Listen, this is the heartbeat of this community working together, creating an environment of support for our youth.
Hooper Bay turned out to be a beautiful little village on the Bering Sea coast. I'd like to thank Principal Dick Cuprak, Richard Cuprak, and also George Smart for helping us with that story. Let's travel now to Southeast Alaska and meet a wonderful woman. Her name is Edna Haaseth.
We're now in the home of Ole and Edna Haaseth. Edna is an elder of Wrangell. She's totally blind and crippled with rheumatoid arthritis, but it doesn't stop her. In fact, here she is making a pair of moccasins. She does all the beading and sewing by hand.
Edna Haaseth is a busy lady, beading and sewing, baking, and generally enjoying her life. Her blindness is simply an inconvenience. This Tlingit woman manages quite well, thank you.
My husband only cuts out the leather moccasins for me and the lining and the tops for it. But he uses the material, any color I want, for design, like eagle design, thunderbird, killer whale, and raven, whatever, or flowers. And then I use my fingertips to go where I'm going to put the beads. And then Ole tells me what color bead is here and there. And then I have to remember where the color beads are. Then I try to not to make mistake, and that's the way I go. I got to use my fingertips. And then in the middle of any design, he puts on common pins, and then I go by that.
This talented Tlingit woman was born in Petersburg around 1913. Edna Haaseth has been blind since she was 13 years old due to an accident. Her family moved to Wrangell. They were the only family in the area that owned a mink ranch. Edna has 5 children. She spends her time sewing and bakes for, according to her daughter Annette, for half the town. No, she just doesn't bake regular food. This woman bakes international fare.
And right in the middle of the rice is a vegetable from Japan. And you put that in the middle of the rice and then roll it up with like a jello roll. And they call that shinshu. And then I cook a few other Japanese food too. And then the Norwegian way is I like to make their cookies and then their pastries. And then their this one cooking is lobster, and that is with potatoes. You just like a pancake, real thin pancake. They call it crepes. And then another thing is the German cooking is a potato dumpling. And they put the salt pork in the middle and make it like a ball. And you cook that in the boiling water for an hour. And you can eat that with pork chops or steaks or fish, whatever you want.
Edna is known for her kindness and generosity. I had a little problem getting her to talk about herself. She'd rather talk about other people and also spend her time giving to others. I know that she didn't want to sound as if she was bragging. That's okay, Edna. I know you're listening to this program. Now thousands of other people around the world will be inspired and touched by your love of life and love for others. I know I am.
The Shishmaref Tannery provides quality services in fur tanning and slipper seals.
Combining modern technology with traditional heritage, serving all Alaska, furs and slippers available at the tannery and select stores.
Owned and operated by the Shishmaref IRA Council. Send your furs to the Shishmaref Tannery.
Call 907-649-3581. Business discounts available upon request.
Annette Thompson, you were so right. Your mother, Edna, is a wonderful person. And I just may take her up on her invitation someday and fly on down and sample some of her wonderful home-baked goods. I want to thank you for joining me for another Heartbeat Alaska. Please continue to send your video to area code 907-272-8111. And I'm still waiting for a video from Nebraska. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Jeannie Green. Please join me again next week for more Native news.
Great Spirit, grant me vision that I may not go wrong and find myself in prison of things I have not done. Teach me the secret that I might see. Fill my heart with compassion to love my enemy. Mother Earth will feed our hunger. Father Sky will love her. Make me worthy of this vision that no human tongue could ever tell. See you.